This is Thoughts Become Things. With each episode, we'll help you reach the highest creative potential that God has for you. With your host, a teacher, life coach, a dream coach, and motivational speaker, Jeremy Lopez.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome to another exciting podcast of Thoughts Become Things. I'm Jeremy Lopez, and once again, I'm honored, I'm thrilled, I'm excited. You guys are joined with me today on this amazing, beautiful week that God has given us, this amazing, beautiful day that God's created for us to enjoy and to create in and to have abundance in and to basically turn situations around for our good. And I'm so glad you guys have decided to join with me today. So I want to talk about today, actually, the power of I am. The power of I am. Now, pretty much people know me throughout the years know that I have sort of coined some terms dealing with the I am-ness and, you know, speaking about the now moment, you know, dealing with law of attraction, dealing with positive thinking and taking it every bit of it from the Bible. And today I want to talk about the power of I am because it's so good to sort of reiterate some things and chew on it some more and get it in our spirits to understand exactly what we're here for. Why am I here and what power do I possess? What power do I hold? And there's a saying that Tony Robbins once said, and that is, when you are grateful, fear disappears and abundance appears. I love that. Now, I want to ask you a question. When we're dealing with the power of I am, we're dealing with God as the I am, but we're also dealing with you as an I am. Now, when I say you as an I am, I'm not dealing with you as the I am. I'm dealing with you as an I am because God is the ultimate I am that I am. We know that from the Bible when it deals with Moses and Pharaoh. And, you know, Moses is saying, well, who do I say sent me, God? And he said, when you go to Pharaoh, just say, I am that I am sent you. I am that I am. And yet, if you think about it, that might sound like, oh, man, I bet he had to do a lot of explaining to do to Pharaoh for Pharaoh to understand, oh, it's not me, woe is me, I'm just a horrible person, and it's God has told me to call him I am, and so this is why I'm here for you. No, he didn't do all that stuff. He just said, go before him and say, I am that I am sent me. I am that I am. Now, when I tell you I am that I am referring to me. Think about that. Because of the fact that if me and you were in a conversation, now once again, leave the Bible out of it for a moment, okay? What you know, what you've studied, what you've been told and taught and everything else. But if I'm in the room with you and we're sitting at the table and I said, I am that I am, you're going to look at me, first of all, and probably wonder a little bit, huh, interesting. But I don't know what he's talking about exactly, but somehow he is definitely talking about himself because within the language of the English language, I am is referring to me. So if I say I am, if I say I am going to the store, that doesn't mean God's going to the store. It means I am going to the store. So if I say I am going to the store, I am poor. Man, I am so distraught. Man, I am so rich. Man, I am so, whatever it is you want to say, but I'm not talking about you, nor am I talking about God. I'm talking about me when I say in a singular, not a plural word of I am. Now, does that mean that Moses went before Pharaoh and says, here's the thing, dude, I am God? Okay. No, what he's saying here is, look, I am bone of his bone, flesh of his flesh, and God has sent me here to instruct you, but while I'm instructing you, I'm also learning about more about myself and him, and me and him, and him and me, and understanding that there is no separation. You know, when we look at science, we understand that even science, and there's no disproving this, folks, we know that according to quantum physics, that everything is jointly connected. No matter how far the universe you go, quantum physics let us know if one thing billions of miles, a light years away is doing a certain frequency or a certain movement, billions of miles away from that is doing the same exact thing. It's called synchronicity. And when you see that life that way, you realize that everything, we can prove everything is actually connected. The universe is one. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about that. We know that to be a fact. Somehow we get into Christianity and it all messes it all up. And does it mean that science trumps or overrides the Bible? Absolutely not. It means the Bible always overcomes everything. But we also know, according to Scripture, that Jesus even prayed, Father, I pray that they're one even as we are one. Now, it doesn't mean that he's saying, here's the idea, God. I know that since I'm the author and finisher of science, that I know everything is actually one and yet yada, yada, yada. No, what he's saying here is he's letting God know, I want them to know they're one. I want them to know that they're one, God, like we're one. Because truthfully, if I'm in me, if I'm in you and you're in me, we're one. You know, Jesus made it very plain. I mean, you know, if you see me, you see the Father, because we're one. And yet he goes on to say later on, he says what? He said, greater works shall you do, because I go to the Father, which basically is letting him know, because I've given you the power, I've given you the essence of who I am. And how do we know that to be a fact? Because you're made my image and likeness. There is no separation between you and God, folks. Contrary to religious demonic dogma, there is no separation between you and the Lord. God doesn't turn around one day and say, oop, here you are, oop, you're gone now, oop, where are you, where are you, can't find you. You know, when we look at Genesis and we see where God says, Adam, Adam, where art thou? It wasn't because God was old or God didn't know where he was. I mean, you can't claim to be God and not know where your own people are. Hello? You can't claim to be Lord of all and not truly be Lord of all. If you're Lord of all, that means you own all and everything belongs to you. All means all, folks, and I don't butt heads about that. I'm very plain about that, very blunt. I don't believe in this separation type of crud that religion tries to put upon us. Jesus makes it very plain. I want them to know they're one, like we're one, God. I mean, come on, we made the universe and we made quantum physics, you know, and so you understand that he says you're in the palm of his hand. You know, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. I mean, we read more scriptures about the power of oneness than anything. And so we understand that what science is letting us know and what God is letting us know through the story of Moses, now that we know all this, is, Moses, I want you to go, but I want you to act like me. I want you to talk like me, because actually you're part of who I am. So man up, dude. Be who I am and go before Pharaoh in my power, my might, as me, and be me, and do what needs to be done. That's what he's saying. In other words, I am, go to him and say, I am that I am. Now that alone, that one statement, we could preach on for years, because there's so many angles and so many sidetracks we could take with this. But because of time, the podcast, I'm here to let you know that what this represents is standing in your own I am-ness. Standing in your own I am-ness, which means let go of the past, let go of the future, live in the now moment, and stand in the title and the entitlement of what belongs to you, of who you are, and whose you belong to, and knowing that you, if you're made in his image and likeness, if his name is I am, then you should be in the likeness of the I am-ness as well, living in, moving in your own I am-ness. What does that mean? Doesn't mean you're taking over God. Doesn't mean we're going to do a hostile, you know, takeover and override God. No, it means we're actually giving God glory. Because what is God said in his word? What does the word say? It says obedience is better than sacrifice. God doesn't want you to sacrifice before him. Oh God, this is so hard for me to do, God. No, you know what? That's what religion teaches you. Work your way to God and he'll be honored and thrilled because he's a mean old God. That's not what religion teaches you. Obedience means if God said it, that settles it. I am that I am. If God said I'm one with him, that settles it. I'm not going to put on some false humility and, oh, woe is me, poor me, I'll never be anything in life. No, obedience means you take on the role of understanding that if Moses said I am that I am to Pharaoh with no explanation, that means I am that I am to my life, and everything I need to know in my life, I update it by bringing it into the now moment and speaking to it from an I am point of view. I have that authority and that power, and the same spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in me. It doesn't say it dwells outside of me. It says he dwells in me. And so that same power, that same Holy Spirit, the same energy, the same anointing, the same presence, the same essence, the same personality, the same persona of God is in me. So wouldn't it make sense to me to be God and to someone to be able to be the hands and feet of God, to speak as God speaks because I'm part of him? You can't rip me away from God. No matter what I ever say or do, folks, unfortunately, now what I mean by unfortunately is praise God, you can't. But what I mean is, in a sarcastic way, unfortunately, you can't separate me from God, nor can I separate you from God. You just can't. And so therefore, the omniscience and the omnipresence of God lets us know that God is in all things. According to Colossians, he is in all, A-L-L, all things. Wait a minute, Jeremy, what about this? Well, all I can tell you is what the Bible says. The Bible says that he is in all things. And all things were created by him, and all things were created for him, and without him, there was not anything made that was made. So how blunt can we be? I mean, when God tells you, has to tell you three times from three different angles, I think that's pretty blunt, don't you think so? And yet we turn around as religious folk and say, oh, but you know what happens when you don't do this. And I want somebody to say, no, what I know is what the Bible tells me. And I'm not going to have your fear-based Christian religion put upon me, because I'm not separated from God, and neither are you, and neither is anyone else. So therefore, I take on the Word of God. Jesus paid the price. And when Jesus paid the price, He did it once and for all. So then, now then, move in the I am-ness of God. So it's better to obey God and to be God for somebody and to be God to your life and attract things into your life and speak from an I am point of view. So let's talk about the I am point of view. That means thinking positive as well. That means updating everything, bringing yourself into the now moment, moving in this place called awareness There was one principle that someone just once said. It was so cool. It says, some people grumble that roses have thorns. I am grateful that thorns have roses. Let me read that again to you. Some people grumble that roses have thorns. I am grateful that thorns have roses. Do you see what happens? Do you see the glass half full or half empty? Because truthfully, folks, the choice is up to you of how you want to see it and perceive it. Your perception, once again, there's that word perception, folks, I bring up every time. Your perception makes you or it breaks you. Your perception tells me your belief, your theology, how you treat people, how you treat yourself, how you look at life. You know, do you see God in all things, or do you see the devil in all things? Do you see everything as being evil and wrong and bad, or do you see, you know, God being and utilizing all things and turning all things around for His good and for our glory, as for our good and for His glory? Which means if He says, I'll turn all things around, that means God can use anything and everything. There's nothing out of the reach of God, nothing out of the hands of God that He can't say, look, if I made it, I can bring it for your good. And no matter if the world distorted it or people said, oh, that's evil, that's bad. I mean, look at Moses for a moment. Look at Moses when the people are getting snake bit. And everyone's getting bit by these snakes. And all of a sudden, you know what? God says, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to take the very thing that is harming them, the very thing that is hurting them. I'm going to take that one thing and turn it around. Because here's the thing. The empowerment is not within the object. You are the one that defines the object to make it evil or make it good. You do. Things can't be evil or good. What makes it evil or good is people who have the intention of shifting the definition to make something seem dirty, evil, bad, or disgusting. Are you with me? A thing, an item, can't be dirty or disgusting. What makes it disgusting and evil is the mind of man. Are you with me? Why? Because we're creators. You know, things of life are not creators. We're creators. Things are things that only obey the word of people. And that's it. The word of the I ams of who we are speaks life and death into things. It's the power of life and death out of our tongue that begins to distort or begins to heal things. That's how life is, folks. And so when you look at yourself, you realize either I can look at the glass half full or half empty, and my perception can either say, this glass is evil, it's disgusting, it's horrible. Many people have taken this glass and drank poison out of it. Look at it. It's not even a full glass of water. In fact, this water's been sitting here for so long, it's probably molded. And guess what I've just done? I have turned the persona, not the cup, not the glass, I've turned the persona of that glass into something evil, wrong, and dirty. But yet I can take it, the same glass, and say, you know what? This glass can be washed out, or this glass actually is not even dirty, and it's half full, and therefore I'm going to rejoice at the fact that it's half full. And the I am as if I am just redefines it. And guess what? If I define it that way, I can shift the minds of others to define it the same way, and it'll be working for their good. And they can drink the water of life out of it. Or they can look at it and pour it out because it's half empty. Are you with me? So if you recognize that situation, you understand, do you see thorns with roses or do you see roses with thorns? It's all up to you on how you want to see and project it. Now, if you look in Matthew chapter 7, verse 7, very interesting to me, but it says, and our famous scripture of all time we love, ask and you shall receive, search and you shall find, knock at the door will be opened to you. Think about that. Ask and it shall be given, seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be opened to you. Which means, is this God that asks? Is this God that seeks? Is it God that knocks? No, it's us. We are. We're the image and likeness of God. So what brings God more glory? What honors God? When we sit back and say, I'm just good for nothing. Oh God, it's all about you. You're so amazing. I'm just a piece of junk, God. I'll never amount to anything. But by your grace, God, I will make it because your word tells me I'll be a survivor. You know, what that's mumbo jumbo demonic garbage. I'm being honest with you, folks. What brings God glory is when we talk like God, walk like God, act like God, because we are God in the flesh. Jesus said, the Bible says that Jesus was the Word made flesh dwelling among the people. Well, folks, you are also a Word made flesh dwelling among the people. You're a Word that God spoke into creation before creation ever began. You have always been and you always will be because you're a spirit having a human experience. And spirits don't die. Spirits have always been, and spirits will always be. And because of that, you are spirit having a natural experience, trying your best to relate to then and awaken to the power of God that was in the, that's in the supernatural in which you really are, and bringing into this natural realm to be able to manifest the things in this natural life, what it is that you know. You know, not you guess, not you're trying to think about, that you know is the truth for you. And the truth is, you should be abundant. You should be healthy. You should be getting along in the place that God wants you to get along. You should be the head and not the tail, above and not beneath. You should be the I am-ness speaking into your world, saying, I am this, I have this, and I am accomplishing this, because I am that I am. And God looks at you and says, you're right, buddy, that's right. Son and daughter of God, you are that you are because you got that from your daddy. Everybody knows, folks, that when you act like your dad, your natural dad, your natural mom, they know that, you know what, there's something instilled in you that I have the privilege to give you. And that, why? Because I believe it comes through the DNA of God, but it also comes through a learning behavior that begins to show you what that DNA that's already in you is supposed to bring to you anyway. And because you're around negative people, they begin to shun you and tell you how evil and horrible you are, and that you're no good and you'll never be anything. And by God's grace, and I want somebody to say, you know what, it is by God's grace, but I'm going to run into the opposite extreme too. I'm going to live on the other side of the cross. It lets me know it's on the finished side of the cross. And that lets me know that, guess what, it's done, it's paid for, so quit trying to make me unworthy now. I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And that settles it for me. Don't tell me anything less than God's very best for me. I am the righteousness. Okay? I am the I am that I am. I am full of grace, compassion, I am loving, I'm kind, I'm generous. I am that, those things that I say that I am. And then your whole life begins to turn and change because the power of life and death as a creator is in your mouth. And you have the power to create a world of joy or create a world of despair. And the choice is left up to you. The ask, seek, and knock doesn't rely on God. Nowhere in that verse does it rely on God. Doesn't mean that we're tearing down God. Not at all. And we're raising God up. We're bringing, if God could even be raised up, because God is neither up or down, but it brings God glory. And how does it happen? Because we're doing what God does. We are people of action. If we're energy and light slow down into matter, which basically means that if you compact, if you compressed energy and light, it would create matter. And what that means is we are pure essence of light and energy. So if I say you're light and you're energy, I mean it. You're light and you're energy. And that means when you know that you're light and you're energy, that means you have to awaken to the true, authentic person that you are. The higher version of yourself. The true self of who you are. That's why you're more spirit than anything. You're a spirit having a human experience. And when you wake up to the energy and the light and the fashion of being spirit that you are, then you understand that, you know what, these things need to dominate my natural being. These things dominate of what I have and don't have in the natural. And so therefore, when I look in the natural world and I see what I don't have, I need to blame only myself. Because it's in my power to ask. It's in my power to seek. It's my power to knock. And guess what? It goes on to say, ask and it shall be given. So what's going to be given to you is what you begin to act by action you need begin to speak on. As seek and you shall find. There's your action right there to seek. As you seek, you're going to find. Knock on that door. There's another action. Knock and the door shall be open to you. It doesn't say if I'm in a good mood, if I'm a bad God, if I've slept enough. No. God says you knock and the door is going to be open to you. And the great thing about the kingdom of God is God said he honors his word above his name. So guess what? You ask, you seek, you knock as the I am-ness of who you are, and you're going to see automatically doors opening up. You're going to begin to find what you're looking for, and you're going to begin to fulfill your destiny that God has in your life. And here's what I would recommend to you. The Bible says, let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Find yourself moving into the I am-ness to say, you know what? I am healthy today. I feel amazing. I am wonderful. I am amazing at my job. I am loving. I am kind to all people. I'm living a peaceful and joyful life. I am free to be me. I am joyful, enthusiastic, and I'm motivated. I am a co-creator of my reality. I am always calm in all situations. I am at peace with my past. I am full of positive, loving energy. I am grateful for my life. I am positive in all situations. I am happy, healthy, and wealthy. I am accepting health into my body now. I am thankful for my healing abilities. I am fit, healthy, and attractive. I am always sharing my joy and my happiness. I am in control of my thoughts and emotions. I am always sharing my smile. I am naturally outgoing and friendly. I am a good person who deserves to be happy. When you set your feet upon the firm rock of your I am-ness, your life, folks, will ultimately radically change. Your life is waiting on the command to come out of your spirit. The treasure in your earthen vessel is wanting to bust forward. It's wanting to blow up. And the only way for it to blow up is when you begin to awaken to the destiny of who you really are. I know for me, I'm not a man that I will one day, or I could have, I should have. No, I'm a man that is I am. I'm a man who says, I will get the job done. I am this right here. I am accomplishing everything that I've ever dreamed and hoped and imagined I would do, because I am that I am. Folks, thank you so much for tuning in to our podcast today. It means a lot to me. It really does. And I want to invite you and want to encourage you, send the invitation to join our website, identitynetwork.net. When you go to our website, identitynetwork.net, I want to encourage you. We have thousands of ebooks and books by publishers all around the globe. I have personally over 200 teachings on our website. You can get as CDs and as digital downloads. I have 27 books out. I would love, encourage you and invite you to purchase. Get our books, get our ebooks. I have courses that will help train you, educate you, open you up and awaken you to things such as law of attraction, to awaken your prophetic anointing inside of you, to awaken the power of understanding your thoughts and understanding how to visualize, which means how to see like God, how to see through the eyes of God. I want to invite you to join our website today, identitynetwork.net. If there's something I can help you with, as a life coach, as a prophet, I'm here to help advance you into the things of God's kingdom. You deserve it, folks. You deserve it. God has died to give you life and life more abundantly. He has given you all things that pertain to life and godliness. And unfortunately, some people just need an extra key to unlock that which lies within them. And that's what I do as a life coach, is I help unlock your destiny that lies inside of you already. I want to get you to vibrate to a new sound. I want you to vibrate like the Bible says, and that is, I hear the sound of the abundance of rain. I want to put you in that vibration to hear that sound and to own that sound and to live in the sound of victory. You deserve it today, folks. Let me help you. Contact my office, 205-362-7133. That's 205-362-7133. When you call, just say, hey, you know what? I want to set up a life coaching session with Jeremy, and they'll walk you through it. Or maybe just get a prophetic word. We ask for a donation for our prophetic words because we are big on missions. And our main job is to get the missions of Identity Network out to where it can feed the world and give them the gospel that is healthy, empowering, and awaken the human soul to let people know who and what they are. God bless you. Thank you so much for tuning into this week. I look forward to hearing from you again next week. God bless.
This has been the Thoughts Become Things podcast with Jeremy Lopez, helping you reach your highest creative potential that God has for you. For more episodes, products, and information on Jeremy, visit www.identitynetwork.net.